Psalm 84 says, "Blessed are those in whose hearts lie the ways to Jerusalem." And so today, even as we symbolically celebrate the entrance of Jesus into the physical Jerusalem, his triumphal entry that we celebrate every Palm Sunday, there's also an invitation to welcome him into our hearts. Those crossed and crowded ways, those confusing paths that lie in us, we welcome Jesus there too. We welcome him as our victorious King, our Savior, and our friend. Let's welcome each other as well. I invite you to stand with me and let us extend the peace of Christ to each other. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, Beth. Peace be with you, Rachel. Peace be with you, Nick. Read the words of the story of Palm Sunday. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem. As he went along, people spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. When he came near the place where the road goes down the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began joyfully to praise God in loud voices for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord." The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." Let's lift our voices singing Hosanna.
Welcome you here. Amen. Would you please be seated? You know, there's just something about the youthful exuberance of a child's joy that sort of seems to be tempered in life as we age, isn't there? And so just as those original palm-waving processional participants were led and aided by the rejoicing voices of children, we too have the joy of sharing in that gift together in worship this morning. So our children have been preparing a song that they are very excited to sing, most of them. Yes? Yes? Woohoo! And I just invite you to allow their joy and energy and enthusiasm and excitement to lift your heart in worship. I defy you not to smile as they sing. Here we go. Jumping up and down, jumping up and down, jumping up and down, shout Hosanna. Jumping.
Great joy, we look to the Lord as we pray to our God and ask Him to forgive us of our sins. Let us pray to the Father. Lord, how good it is to be in your house, to be gathered together as the family of God, and to celebrate you, O God, our good shepherd, our faithful king, our rock, our redeemer, our strength, our all in all. And God, as we have gathered here today, we cry out those words, Hosanna to the highest, praying, Lord, save us. Lord, help us. God, when we peer into our own lives, we see more and more how much we need you. We see our failings, our shortcomings, our offenses. God, we see our sin. God, we take this moment not only to acknowledge our sin, but to ask you to forgive us of our sins. Lord, would you hear our silent prayers of confession? God, we thank you that you are far better than the eraser that leaves marks. We're so thankful that you don't expunge our record, but you are one that pardons us, that you eliminate all sin and all traces of sin, and you forgive us completely. Totally. And God, we bask in this forgiveness, Lord. This forgiveness that you've given us, it gives us so much joy and so much gratitude, Lord, knowing that we know that we are unworthy. But Lord, we are so thankful for your grace and the abundance of your grace that you pour out upon us. And Lord, it makes us want to jump. It makes us want to sing. It makes us want to dance. It makes us want to celebrate you because you have forgiven us. You have washed us and you have made us clean. Lord, you have saved us. And I pray, God, that this week that we would find ourselves filled with so much joy because you've forgiven us, because you've washed us, and because you have saved us. And may our hearts burst forth and sing Hosanna to the highest. We celebrate you, God. You are the one who says, therefore, if any man is in Christ, he is a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, you've made all things new. We pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Let us continue to lift up our voices, celebrating that when we look at Jesus, we see salvation.
Thank you. I don't know if I'm really qualified to be doing this, but our two regular correspondents are off on a safari with Caligula, and the child labor laws here in Jerusalem are non-existent. But the news of the day is that Jesus came riding into Jerusalem. Everybody was there to see it. And Naya, can you tell the audience a little bit what was going on?
It was a huge crowd. Everyone was waving palm branches.
Why palm branches?
Palm branches mean victory. It's a celebration that Jesus is king.
Interesting. Nolan, what else was happening?
Everyone was shouting, Hosanna!
Hosanna!
Not all of our viewers speak Hebrew. Can you explain what Hosanna means?
Hosanna means save us. The crowds are expecting Jesus to be their savior.
Emma, what else interesting was happening?
Well, Jesus rode a donkey, which is very strange.
Strange how?
Well, would you be expecting him to be riding a horse? Kings ride horses. Donkeys are just silly.
We're reporting on Jesus of Nazareth.
You know, know that Jesus cares about us. He's always made time for us, and he is the Son of David.
Lucas, what does that mean, the Son of David?
He's the one we've been waiting for.
You were all singing a song when Jesus came in. Nicole, can you tell us what song that was?
We were singing Psalm 118, Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord.
Do you really believe that Jesus is the one who has come to save us?
Yes.
Today's scripture reading comes from Matthew 21, 1 through 16. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, "Go to the village ahead of you, and at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt with her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, tell them that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away." This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet, "Say to the daughter of Zion, see, your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." The disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They brought the donkey and the colt, placed their cloaks on them, and Jesus sat on them. A very large crowd spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. The crowds that went ahead of them and those that followed shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest." When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city was stirred and asked, "Who is this?" The crowds answered, "This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee." Jesus entered the temple area and drove out all who were buying and selling there. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the benches of those selling doves. "It is written," he said to them, "My house will be called a house of prayer, but you have been making it a den of robbers." The blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and the teachers of the law saw the wonderful things he did, and the children shouting in the temple area, "Hosanna to the Son of David," they were indignant. "Do you hear what these children are saying?" they asked him. "Yes," replied Jesus. "Have you never read, 'From the lips of children and infants you have ordained praise'?" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
This Lenten season, we've been using the idea of eyewitness news. That's why we've been having all these little newscasts every Sunday. And I hope that many of them being amusing, we also picked up on the idea that these are real events that happen to real people. And much like the things that happen in our lives, everyone had different interpretations of them. We've heard from these various newscasts that some thought Jesus was a political figure, he was a revolutionary looking to set up an earthly kingdom. Others thought he was a religious figure, a prophet, someone coming to reform the religious movements in Jerusalem. But wherever Jesus went, it was a scandal, there was confusion, it was a little bit of a mess. We've been taking as kind of our theme verse as we travel through Matthew's gospel, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, where Peter says, "We do not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." So throughout this series, we've been on the ground in Jerusalem watching these events as Jesus travels, as Jesus teaches, as Jesus was arrested and found guilty. And we have been trying to see that which Peter talks about, that Jesus has come in power. This was not just another revolutionary. This was not just another religious reformer. This is the Son of David. This is the King. This is the Messiah that we have been waiting for. That's been our invitation this Lenten season. Now today, as we enter Holy Week, we're going to double down on these questions. Who is Jesus? What kind of king is he? This morning, as we look through the story in Matthew 21, the story of Jesus coming to Jerusalem, his triumphal entry, these are the three questions we'll ask. First, what kind of king is Jesus? Second, what kind of kingdom is he bringing? And third, how is he bringing this kingdom? So first we ask, what sort of king is Jesus? And you know that the disciples were wondering the same thing. They've been following Jesus for about 3 years, and they know that this is the moment. We're going to Jerusalem, and it's a hotbed. Things are going to happen this week. And so they're getting ready to enter Jerusalem, and Jesus says, we're about to go down. They're on the Mount of Olives, the text says, and if you know about Jerusalem, Jerusalem was a city built on a mountain, on a large hill. It was easily fortified because no matter where you were coming from, people could look down and see you coming up to the city. And so any kind of entrance is going to be noticed. Any kind of entrance is going to make a splash. And so they're gathered on the Mount of Olives, which is that last hill before it goes down into the valley and then back up into Jerusalem. And they say, this is the moment. We're gonna make our entry into Jerusalem. How do you want to do this, Jesus? How do we want to announce our coming? In verse 1, Jesus says, or verse 2, Jesus says, well, go get me a donkey. And the disciples are like, a what now? A donkey? As we heard in the newscast, this is not the way you enter a city if you're trying to make a statement. A donkey. Jesus, don't you mean a horse? Don't you mean, the conversation we should be having is not donkey versus horse. The conversation we should be having is what color horse? Because, you know, in those days, riding a black horse into town would mean one thing. Riding a white horse, a charger into town would mean another. Those are the sort of conversations we want to be having, but a donkey? It's strange. Rulers, conquerors, heroes, big figures from history, they ride horses. I don't even know what to compare this to. When we think of an enormous figure, some political figure, some military figure, some powerful figure coming to town, we think they're going to ride in a limo, or there's going to be a long line of black SUVs, all of them bulletproof, or there's going to be a Jeep or a Hummer, a clearly a military vehicle, and that's going to send a message about what they're here to do. Maybe you could make a case for a German prime minister to ride a Volkswagen into town, showing off, this is our German engineering. We make better cars than anyone else. But a donkey, that's the equivalent of riding a muddy, falling apart work truck into town. Or when I worked on a farm, we would have a 15-passenger van that we would take workers from field to field in, and those seats, like you could hit them and dust clouds would come up and it stank and it was dirty. There was mud on the ground and it was supposed to be a white van, but it was really kind of brown because it was so covered in mud. This is like riding that into town. This is that sort of message. What are you doing, Jesus? Well, verses 4 and 5 of Matthew 21 explain exactly what he's doing by quoting from a prophecy in the Old Testament from the book of Zechariah. The prophecy says, say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey. That's the adjective that Jesus wants to portray. What kind of king is he going to be? And he chooses the word gentle. And we think, Jesus, in times like these, we don't need gentle. That's not an adjective that we want to associate with our rulers, our heroes, our rescuers. Gentle, that's not what a time like this calls for. We want decisive. We want get things done. We want commanding. We want a little bit intimidating, someone you want on your side, because if he's not on your side, oh, he's scary. We want fierce. We want imposing. We want powerful. But we certainly don't want gentle. A gentle kind of king. That's not what the world needs, especially not right now, Jesus. We're under the oppression of Rome, and we have all these problems. We don't need gentle. Maybe someday, you know, far away, when all these problems are taken care of, then we'll have time for gentle, but we don't have time for that right now. Now, we have, as a human race, a long history of intimidating, powerful kings and queens and rulers and emperors and heroes. We have a long history of what we might call war horse riders. The people of Jerusalem would have known this. They had seen the emperor riding into town on his royal horse. They had seen Pilate 4 years before these events come into town and take up his position as governor, riding a war horse, sending a message, "I am here to rule and get you in line." They had seen Herod, this kingly figure, riding around on his horse with all this pomp and saying, "I am important." And we're used to this too. We've seen the strategists, the empire-minded, the prime ministers, the presidents, and we've gladly followed these war horse type figures, saying, "This is how you get things done. This is how you achieve success. Might makes right. This is how we fix the world." But Jesus comes on a donkey, mocking each and every one in that long line. This is what the Psalms talk about. Many times, if you read the Old Testament Psalms, these songs and prayers of God's people, there's many times that they say, well, some trust in their horses, some trust in their chariots. And this is exactly what they're talking about, these powerful figures that we think get things done. That's where we put our trust. Horses, chariots, tanks, military, presidents, congresses, whoever it might be, that's who will fix this for us. But Jesus riding on a donkey makes a mockery of all of them. And for now, the crowd plays along. They've been waiting for Jesus. They knew this was going to be a big moment, and maybe they're, I don't know what this donkey is about, but he's coming to Jerusalem. This is exciting. Let's celebrate this. So they laid their cloaks on the road, and that's an Old Testament image from the book of 2 Kings, where laying cloaks on a road was a way of basically putting your allegiance to a new king. In 2 Kings, there was a new king coming to town, and everyone who laid their cloaks on the road to welcome him, they were saying, "This is the king we'll follow. We're going to depose this old king." That's what this crowd was trying to do, say, "Jesus is the ruler we want, not Rome, not Pilate, none of these oppressors." They were waving palm branches, that sign of victory. They were shouting, "Hosanna, come and save us." That's what that word means, save us, save us. We're being oppressed, we're broken, we're hurting. They were calling him the Son of David. That was a title for the coming king, the prophesied one who would make things right. They were caught up in this moment. They were excited. They put all of their imagined ideas of what a king should be, they put it on Jesus. They missed the point of the donkey. They were caught up in the moment. But then they ended in verse 10 asking, "Well, who is this?" And the crowds answered, "Well, it's Jesus, this small town prophet, but we hope he's something more." Well, the same question comes to us today. Who is this? Who is this? This one who chose a donkey in a world of war horses. This one who chose gentleness in a world obsessed with power. This one who makes a mockery of the systems that run this world, the militaries, the nations, the ideas that we think will keep us safe and comfortable. He makes a mockery of them. Who is this? And the crowds kind of sit back and say, "Well, we'll wait and see. We'll see if he does what we hope he will do." And they watch as Jesus performs his first act as king. So that's our second question. What kind of kingdom is Jesus bringing? And he demonstrates exactly that beginning in verse 12. Jesus enters Jerusalem on the donkey, and then he goes into the temple. And he performs this prophetic sign of turning over the tables and driving out the money changers, driving out the animal sellers. And this behavior demonstrates exactly what kind of king Jesus is trying to be. Now, we talked about this a few weeks ago, but the way the temple was laid out, according to Old Testament traditions and customs, was there was the temple proper, and then there was a courtyard around that where only the priests could go. And then there was a courtyard around that where Jewish men could go. And then there was a courtyard around that where if you were a woman or if you were a Gentile, a non-Jewish person, that's where you could come and worship. And when the time came that they said, you know, we need these money changers, we need these animal sellers to make worship more convenient, to make worship work, where should we put all these booths and tables? Well, they said, let's put them in the courtyard where women and foreigners worship, because, you know, are they really going to show up? And if they do show up, do they really need that much room? Let's just set it up there. And so that turned into this whole marketplace that kept women and foreigners from worshiping in the temple. They said, keeping our systems running is more important than some people. Some people don't matter as much as our comfort. Some people don't matter as much as our money. Some people don't matter as much as our way of doing things. And now Jesus' first act as king is to burst in and clear a space. And as he's doing so, he quotes from Isaiah 56, saying, my house is supposed to be a house of prayer for the nations to come in, and you're not giving them any room. In fact, so he quotes from Isaiah 56 verse 7. And Isaiah 56 verse 8, this passage that was Jesus on Jesus' mind as he did this, Isaiah 56 verse 8 says, God's intention is to gather still others beside those already gathered. Our God is a gathering God, and you're filling up his space. There's no room for him to gather. So Jesus is demonstrating that he's a gathering king, a gentle king who gathers people to himself. Now, all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, tell this story. It's pretty crucial to understanding what Jesus came to do. But only Matthew gives us one particular detail. All the Gospels explain that Jesus overturned tables and drove out the money changers, drove out the buyers and sellers, making room. But only Matthew tells us who filled up that room. Matthew's the only person that says that after Jesus turned over the tables and drove people out, the blind and the lame and the children came to him and filled up that space he had created. And I wonder why Matthew's the only one that gives us that detail. My hypothesis is this. If you know about Matthew, the disciple of Jesus, you know that he was, before he started following Jesus, a tax collector. And what tax collectors were in Palestine in those days is they were Jewish people that after Rome had come in, they said, you know, I don't know if there's much hope for God's people. Maybe we should just play along with this Roman way of doing things. In fact, I'm going to work together with the Romans. I'm going to collect taxes for them, and maybe I'll pocket a little bit extra on the side. So they were people who willingly compromised themselves to work with the oppressive Roman government. So they were not popular at all. In fact, the gospel tells us that Matthew's name was actually Levi. And if you know the Old Testament story, you know that Levi was the name of the tribe of people that were priests. The Levites were priests, and priests were supposed to stand between God's people and God and help this relationship between God and his people. But instead, Levi, Matthew, had chosen to stand between the people in Rome and help that relationship. He was compromised, he was broken, and he was unpopular. Everyone hated the tax collectors. They were compromisers. They gave up on God's promises. But then Jesus came to Matthew and said, you, follow me. Jesus did that gathering action, bringing this tax collector into his kingdom. And so I would imagine, and this is just a hypothesis, I would imagine that Matthew was very sensitive to this kind of inclusion, this kind of gathering, this kind of welcome, because it had happened to him. And so he noticed, as he was writing this gospel, he noticed that when Jesus drove out the tax collectors, drove out the money changers, turned over the tables, creating room, he noticed who filled that room, because he had been in that situation too. And it says it's the blind and the lame, and Jesus healed them. It's the children, and they sang. See, that's the thing about children. If any of you are parents, you know that kids kind of hang on to things a little too long. Like you're singing a song, maybe one about a young shark. I don't even want to say the title of it. But you're singing that song, and it just goes on and on, and they don't know when to stop. I'm like, I can do like 20. 12 verses, but then I'm done. But they're not. Or if you're singing anything, like, they'll just keep on going and going. It's like, oh my goodness. Well, that's what these kids were doing with Hosanna. The crowds had dispersed, but there were a bunch of kids, it says, verse 15, children that followed along, and they kept singing, Hosanna, the Son of David. So here's Jesus clearing the temple and gathering the blind and the lame in, giving them room, gathering them, and children are still there, keeping up the Hosanna song, still singing Psalm 118 over and over and over and over. And of course, like most adults, there were those who were, the text says, indignant. That's how I feel when kids keep on singing. I'm indignant. How dare these kids? Like, the time is over. And Jesus says, I'm happy they're here. They need to keep singing. They need to keep telling the world what I am doing. The crowds were caught up in the moment. They sang their song. But when Jesus entered the temple and drove out the money changers and challenged the systems that had made them comfortable, they kind of gave up. But the children kept on. The children, this is the thing about children. Children can imagine a better future. Children talk about what might happen in the future, and we're like, oh, you know, hang on to that precious dream for as long as you can, because soon you're going to grow up and you're going to find out that's not the way things work. They don't know any better. The world doesn't work like that. They said, no, like someday there can be peace. Someday, you know, we can feed the hungry people. You know, they come up with these ideas of how the world works, and we're like, oh, that's precious. But that's not going to happen. The minute you say that, though, you're revealing that the war horse has got you. You're saying, oh, Jesus, this gentle kingdom, this gathering kingdom with space for, you know, the blind and the lame, that's sweet, but it's never going to work. We'll always need our war horses. This might be nice for an afternoon, Jesus, but we need to go back to the war horses. We need to go back to the military. We need to go back to the guns and the swords and the bullets, because that's what's going to get things done. This is nice for this afternoon, but no, 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 no. But Jesus comes in trading a war horse for a donkey, trading a military for a choir of children, trading a gun for a trowel, a sword for a plowshare, a bullet for a cross. And the blind and the lame and the children are the only ones who get it. The children see what Jesus is doing, creating space for the blind and the lame, and they think, this is what the world could be. I'm going to keep on singing. They can envision a brighter future. They can hope that things will change. And where we see child foolishness, Jesus sees his kingdom coming on earth as it is in heaven. That's why he says, do you want to be great in my kingdom? Become like a child. Imagine this, see this. Because Jesus chose to disappoint everyone, riding a donkey and then eventually headed to die. That was a disappointment. He didn't live up to anything that people wanted him to do. He chose to be a disappointment. He chose to go to the cross so that we could transfer our hope from the war horses to the cross. The cross is our story of redemption. And to conclude this sermon, we've talked about what kind of king Jesus is, what kind of kingdom he brings. The final question is, how does he bring this kingdom? And I want to invite the children forward to help us understand how Jesus brings his kingdom. So as you kids are coming forward, I want you to imagine the most precious thing you have in your room. If you have your own room, or even if you have your own little space in your room, maybe you filled it with precious things. Maybe you have, I don't know, an autographed baseball from your favorite baseball player or football or whatever sport you like. Maybe you have a poster of your favorite character. Maybe you have a rock that you found on your favorite vacation And whenever you look at that rock, it reminds you of that special time that you spent. Or maybe there's a gift that your grandma gave you, a stuffed animal that you just love and hug every night, and it's getting all tattered, but you love it so much. Those are all the precious things that you have in your bedroom. Now, can you imagine if someone broke into your bedroom and took all that stuff? Stuff like a rock that is precious to you, but maybe a grown-up would be like, it's just a rock. But that rock that means something because you found it on that vacation. Or that stuffed animal that you're like, it's just tattered and torn. Like, why would this matter? But to you, it's, this is a precious thing from my grandma. Or any of those precious things you have, your blanket that you've had since you were a kid, and it's all falling apart, but it's so precious to you. All these precious things. What if someone took it from you and said, I'll only give it back to you if you give me $1 million? And grown-ups would say, $1 million for that rock, for that blanket, for that stuffed animal? What? That's silly. It's not worth that much. But to you, it's worth so much. And if you had $1 million, you would gladly give it to get it back. Well, that's what the Bible word redemption means. It means that something precious needs to be bought back. It means that you have this thing, this blanket, this rock, whatever it is, and you're like, I need it around me. I want it to be here because it's part of who I am. And that's what Jesus says about each one of you. You are precious to Jesus, even more so than whatever your precious thing that you're imagining right now. You are more precious to Jesus than that, times a million. And Jesus was willing to pay the price to get you back. Jesus looks at each one of you and says, I want you here. You are an important part of who I am, and I need you near me, and I'm willing to pay any price to get you here where you belong. That's what the word redemption means. So when we say, I've been redeemed, it means that Jesus is the sort of king that was willing to go to the cross to pay that enormous price just to have us in his family. So when we sing, I've been redeemed, that's something to shout about, that's something to celebrate, that's something to be exuberant about. And so let's sing together now, I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb.
By the blood of the Lamb.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb.
Let's go back and sing that first verse all together.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb.
By the blood of the Lamb.
I've been redeemed.
I've been redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb.
Been redeemed. A few announcements to share before we pray. We express our Christian sympathy to Nancy Asmus and her family in the passing of Bob this past Wednesday. There will be a memorial service on Wednesday, April 27th, beginning at 11 a.m. here at the church. We also express our Christian sympathy to Ann Colville and her family in the passing of our brother Hank, who passed away into glory during the night. Both Bob and Hank were beloved brothers and leaders here in our church. We celebrate their testimony of trust in Jesus and the friendship they share with so many. We pray for our peace and our comfort for all those who mourn. Let us look to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God, our Father, our great shepherd, our refuge, our rock, and our provider. God, you are our everything. You are our peace in chaos. You are our source of joy in a sad world. You are our standard for life and love. You are our liberator and redeemer. God, we are so thankful to worship you. God, there's no one like you and no one beside you. You, Father, are great and greatly to be praised. Thank you for your presence that's among us this morning. Thank you for providing for us the forgiveness of our sins. Thank you for bridging the gap to bring us into relationship with you. Father, we are so thankful. We're thankful for all the tangible blessings that we experience each and every day. And God, we will shout it from the rooftops, from the mountaintops, from the hills, and from the valleys that you are good to us. You have answered many prayers from this place, and we're thankful. We're thankful for all those who've been healed and delivered. We're thankful for the jobs that have been provided, for the relationships that have been restored, from the chains that have been broken. We're thankful again this morning that you hear us. As we intercede for our brothers and our sisters who are in need of your divine help. For God, you told us to be anxious for nothing, but in all things we should pray with supplication and thanksgiving. Let our requests be made known to you. So God, we present before you our request. Lord, we pray this morning for Nancy and her family as they grieve the promotion of Bob to glory. Father, we ask that you would be with this family and that you would comfort them and that you would be their help. God, we pray the same for Ann and for her family, Lord, that Lord, in this season, that they would lean on you and that they would find strength and comfort and help from you. Lord, we pray for Felix and Chinadu as they travel to Nigeria. We ask, God, that you would give her strength in her body. And we ask that their trip will be safe and rewarding. Father, we pray for Celeste. We ask that you would bring healing to her body and peace to her mind. Lord, we give you thanks that Lindsay is in remission. And we give you thanks that Tom is home. And we ask that you would continue to bring healing and recovery. Lord, we continue to pray for Lula as she continues treatment. Lord, would you give her body strength as she keeps fighting? Lord, we pray for our sister Felicia. God, we ask that you would be her help and her hope. Father, gird her on every side. And Lord, we know that there are many other requests and needs from those under the sound of my voice, for those who will be watching online today and this week. Father, we ask that you will bring healing where healing is needed. We ask that you will bring joy where there's sadness, that you would give peace where there's chaos, that you bring order where there's disorder. We ask that you bring provision where there's lack. We ask that you would dress us all with your favor. May we wear favor as a man wears a coat. Lord, would you pour out your super on our natural and help us to be fruitful for you. Father, we think of those who are in Ukraine, those who are filled with courage and fear. Lord, we ask that you would bring peace to that land, and that you would cause war to cease. We pray for those who are grieving and hurting there because of a loved one that's been killed. Father, would you pour out your grace? And Lord, show us how we can help. Father, we also pray for the church in Ukraine. God, we ask that you would strengthen their minds, strengthen their spirits, increase their faith, and help them not to go weary in the midst of all of this. And Lord, may in this season, may the gospel flourish. Father, we not only pray for peace in Ukraine, but we pray for peace around the world. We pray for peace here in the Chicagoland area. Father, as we are always inundated with bad news, we celebrate the fact that in Chicago that there is good work and good news that is happening. And Father, we think of your servants, organizations, and people who are serving in great ways, sharing your love, your kindness, and your mercy to so many. We ask that you would continue to resource them and to provide for them. Continue to give them vision and strategy. And may they too sense your presence. And God, we ask that you would free them from discouragement. And we pray you would continue to arm them with the gospel and help them to continue to have the courage to make disciples. Father, we ask that you would help us in tough times and in good times to continue to singing this great gospel song, to continue to singing that we have been redeemed, to continue to sing the song that you have saved us. God, help us to continue to sing and to praise you, Lord, because we will forever and in all of eternity declare that you are worthy. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain before the foundation of the world. And God, as we continue to praise you, we continue to look to you from where comes our help. And as we continue to look to you, we pray the words that you taught your disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, power, and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, we have the blessed opportunity to give our tithes and our offerings, and our deacons will come to serve us.
Our Father in heaven, today we celebrate Jesus riding into Jerusalem in triumph, but we also know that he rode into Jerusalem to die for us. And so we thank you for that sacrifice. We thank you for that redemption. We thank you that he was willing to lay down his life, to pay that great cost, just so that he could call us his brothers and sisters. We do pray that we would give these gifts with that same gratitude, that same joy, that same love, so that your kingdom would be expanded here on earth as it is in heaven. Make us cheerful givers as we go out into this week. In Jesus' name, amen. I ask you to please be seated for a moment as there are a few announcements. The first announcement is in the form of a video. I'm going to say two words, and I want you to say the first word or phrase that comes to mind. 5, 10,
15, 20,
5, 10,
15,
5, 10.
15,
20.
5:10.
Time.
5:10.
15.
5:10. Time of day.
5:10.
5:10. 15.
5:10.
5:10.
5:10. So everyone's going to ask during coffee time. So I will just give you my answer now. If you ask me, I will say this was Jim DeGroat's idea. And then he fled to Mexico. So you have to wait till he gets back. A few other things. Of course, today is Palm Sunday. We're entering into Holy Week or Passion Week. And the culmination of Holy Week is, of course, the celebration of Easter next Sunday. And 2 years ago, we had to cancel our services on March 15 because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And at that time, foolishly, hopefully, optimistically, I thought it was only going to be a 3 or 4 or 5 week matter. And so in one of our videos that we sent out during that first lockdown, I said, don't worry, we're all going to be back together on Easter, and we'll sing the Hallelujah Chorus, and it will be our great big welcome back. Well, that didn't happen. That first year in 2020, Easter was completely digital, online. Last year, we were still practicing social distancing, and we thought a whole big old choir would be an unwise decision. Well, this year, with various advice from medical professionals, we are going to have a choir on Easter for those who are comfortable participating. And so we are going to be singing the Hallelujah Chorus on next Sunday. So we're very excited about that. We're very excited about having a choir involved in our service again. And there's still time for you to be part of that choir. They are going to be practicing this Wednesday at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. So if you want to join our choir, there's still time this Wednesday at 7 p.m. We practiced last week, and it was such a joy to hear and to be part of that. So if anyone's interested, Wednesday at 7 p.m. is rehearsal for choir. Thursday is Maundy Thursday. We'll be having a service in our fellowship hall at 6 p.m. We ask that you sign up if you're planning on attending our Maundy Thursday service, because there will be a light meal or heavy refreshments, however you want to look at it, involved in that service. So please sign up at the Welcome Center in the Narthex or downstairs if you are planning on attending our Maundy Thursday service at 6 p.m. on Thursday in the Fellowship Hall. We'll also be having our Good Friday service at 6 p.m. here in the sanctuary on Friday. You don't have to sign up for that, but we hope that we see you there for that important service as well. So we're very excited about all these opportunities to be gathered back together and worship together in this Holy Week. I invite you to stand again and lift up your hearts to receive God's blessing. Blessed is the one who comes to us by the way of love poured out with abandon. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who walks toward us by the way of grace that holds us fast. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who by gentleness challenges our hard hearts and opens space that all may come in. Hosanna. Blessed is the one who calls us to follow in the way of blessing, in the path of joy. Hear the voice of Jesus today calling, I need you here. Let his grace, mercy, and peace come upon you today and settle in around you. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.